Good morning, brothers and sisters in Christ and friends. A warm welcome to Wesley Methodist Church Ipoh online worship service. Today is Aldersgate Sunday. We gather to commemorate a pivotal event in John Wesley's life. He joined a meeting at Aldersgate Street, London, with a heavy heart. But he left with his heart strangely warmed. The Holy Spirit ministered deeply in his heart. And may the same Holy Spirit minister to each of us as we gather to worship Him. Let us together celebrate Jesus Christ.
Jesus. Of who you are, Lord, we do not worship in vain, Lord. Father, we thank you, Lord, that you're such a mighty God, yet you love us, Lord, so personally, so intimately, Lord, and that you're a Father to us, Lord, and that we can relate to you. As we sing this last song, we want to remember your goodness, and we want to remember how faithful you are to us. May this song be a sweet sound unto you, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Known you as a father, I've known you as you have been faithful. In all my life you have been so, so good. In every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running out, it's running out. Goodness is running out, it's running out to me. With my life laid down, I've surrendered now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running out, it's running out to me. Your goodness is running out, it's running out to me. Your goodness is running out, it's running out. Lay down and surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running out. It's running out for me.
And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. And every breath that I am able, oh, I'm gonna sing of the goodness of God. And I'm gonna sing of the goodness of God. Oh, I'm gonna sing of the goodness of God. I'm gonna sing of the goodness of God.
Good morning, church. Today's scripture reading is taken from Romans chapter 4, verses 13 to 17. Romans chapter 4, verse 13. It was not through the law that Abraham and his offspring received the promise that he would be heir of the world, but through the righteousness that comes by faith. For if those who depend on the law are heirs, faith means nothing, and the promise is worthless. Because the law brings wrath, and where there is no law, there is no transgression. Therefore, the promise comes by faith, so that it may be by grace and may be guaranteed to all Abraham's offspring, not only to those who are of the law, but also to those who have the faith of Abraham. He is the father of us all, as it is written, I have made you a father of many nations. He is our father in the sight of God, in whom he believed, the God who gives life to the dead and calls into being things that were not. This is the word of the Lord.
Good morning, church. We are so glad and joyful that we can worship God together this morning, wherever you are. And before we begin, let us pray. Eternal God, our Father, we thank and we praise you that we, your people, can worship you wherever we are this morning, and that your presence is with us. And we pray, O God, our Father, that you unite our hearts, our minds, our spirit together in worship you this morning. And we know, God, our Father, that you are going to speak to us. You have your word for us this morning. So I pray, Father, that you clear all hindrances so that we can have a direct access into your presence. And when you speak, we can hear your word to us. And this morning, this day, we are commemorating Aldersgate Sunday, the Sunday of God our Father, the day when your servant John Wesley had his heart warmed by your word and your Holy Spirit. And we pray for the spiritual warming of our hearts, ourselves, our families, and our church this morning. And we pray, Father, that you speak to us, that your word be clear to us as it is being spoken by your servant. Let our worship of you this morning, O God, our Father, come before you as morning sacrifices, sweet and pleasant in your sight. And we pray, Father, that you minister to our needs. For those who need healing, we pray, Father, for your healing touch to be upon them, wherever they are. For those who need your words of comfort, we pray, Father, that you comfort them. And those with anxious mind and spirit, we pray, Father, in the same manner, that you comfort them. We pray all this and give thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. Church, today is Aldersgate Sunday. Some of you have visited Aldersgate Street in London. Now, how is that street linked to Methodist Aldersgate? Aldersgate Sunday is the day when the Methodists commemorate the heartwarming experience of John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist Church. John Wesley's heartwarming experience happened at a place located along Aldersgate Street, London. John Wesley's heartwarming experience occurred on 24th May 1738 at about 8:45 p.m. Now tonight at 8:45 p.m. you might want to experience the heartwarming experience of John Wesley. And if you do, I pray that the Holy Spirit will minister to you. Now today is May 24th. So May 24th, or the Sunday closest to May 24th, is Aldersgate Sunday for the Methodists. Now much has been said about John Wesley's heartwarming experience. Some thought he had lost his faith. And then on that day and night, May the 24th, he regained his faith. Let's look at what John Wesley had said about his heartwarming experience. And you will find this on slide number 4. Let us read together. I felt I did trust Christ alone for salvation, and an assurance was given me that he had taken away my sin, even mine, and saved me from the law of sin and death. Well, his heartwarming experience dawned on him when he was listening to someone reading from the preface of the book of Romans. Now this passage that has been read to us, Romans chapter 4, 13 to 17, is about salvation by believing in God and by His grace working in us and perfecting us. Let us ask ourselves, have I ever had such warming experience as a Christian? Even as I'm preaching, I like us all to pray for a heartwarming experience, a heart set free from sin, and having assurance of our salvation in Jesus Christ. You know, I had my heartwarming experience before, and that was when I personally confessed my faith in Jesus Christ and gave my life to Him. I was then 18 years old. Friends, being born and raised in a Christian home does not make one a saved Christian. One has to personally believe and confess his faith in Jesus. Now, many children in Christian home do not know that they must personally believe in Jesus and confess their faith in him, and to welcome Jesus into their life as their personal Lord and Savior. So, well, parents, you can prayerfully lead your children to confess their faith and their belief in Jesus Christ. Another of my heartwarming experiences was at Chifu Methodist Center during a prayer conference, when the preacher placed his hand on me and prayed for the anointing of the Holy Spirit upon my life. Friends, your heartwarming experience may not be 100% like that of John Wesley. However, your heartwarming experience must include repentance of sin, renouncing of sins, and praying to receive Jesus Christ into your life as your Lord and Savior. What the heartwarming experience meant to John Wesley. John Wesley's heartwarming experience was a lifelong journey of learning and maturing in his faith. John Wesley was brought up in a home of strict scriptural learning and practice. Susanna, the mother, was the tutor of the homeschooling. Well, many parents do homeschooling with their children. Now, John Wesley's homeschooling was from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. with 2 hours of lunch break. Other than Bible knowledge, they learned alphabet, ABC, and other school subjects. At age 5, John Wesley and his other siblings were taught to read the Bible verse by verse. At age 6, John Wesley was serious about his faith. Acts of lying, pilfering, disobedience, quarreling were dealt with severely. John Wesley's mother, Susanna, recognized that any inclination to sin in children must be meet at the bar. It reminds us of original sin. Well, it is said, if a child lives with criticism, he learns to condemn. If a child lives with hostility, he learns to fight. On the other hand, if a child lives with tolerance, he learns to be patient. If a child lives with fairness, he learns justice. Parents and household members, be careful how you live your life. Now, John Wesley's upbringing gives us some idea about nurturing faith and good behavior in our homes. Next, engaging our faith with the real world. The day came when John Wesley attended former school at Charterhouse School in London. This was the time when John Wesley was exposed to the real world with his sins, temptation, and vices. His Christian training, his Christian nurturing was put to the test. For many youngsters of our days, it is a celebration of freedom to be away from home. And being away from home for the first time, many kids acquire bad and sinful habits. John Wesley, like many youngsters, felt the pull of sin in words as well as in deeds. Being a smart student, John Wesley got a place to study in Oxford University to pursue his tertiary education. Now, university life was much more challenging for John Wesley. Having to cope with studies, assignment, exam, there are reasons to compromise spiritual pursuit, such as quiet time, Bible study, as well as Sunday worship. Our busy daily life will also cause us to compromise with spiritual discipleship. Now, seeing that Christian students were wavering in their faith, John, together with his brother Charles, organized holy clubs, similar to our college or varsity Christian fellowship, to keep on nurturing and strengthening the faith of students through Bible study, prayer, fasting, and fellowshipping together. And to our students in colleges and uni, I hereby urge you to join the Christian fellowship in your campus and to worship in church on Sundays. Parents, there is something I noticed about the faith of John and Charles Wesley. Why was the faith remained fervent even though they felt the pulling to sin? All parents must heed this counsel of Proverbs in chapter 6, verse 16 to 19. Will you turn with me to the Bible, Proverbs chapter 6, verse 16 to 19. I read, "There are six things the Lord hates, seven that are detestable to him: haughty eyes, a lying tongue, hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that devises wicked schemes, feet that are quick to rush into evil, a false witness who calls out lies, and a man who stirs up dissension among brothers," and of course, many other teachings as well. All of John Wesley's faith nurturing as a child, plus his faith encounters in the real world, and his wanting to be right about salvation and other encounters, they all contributed to his heartwarming experience on May 24, 1738. Therefore, brothers, sisters in Christ, we need to be serious with our Christian faith at some point of our life. The sooner, the better it is for us. Coming to assurance of personal salvation, another spiritual encounter dimension that John Wesley had to encounter was to have assurance of personal salvation. And you know, personal salvation becomes real and urgent when Christians are facing death. Christians on deathbed are comforted by the assurance that they are saved in Jesus Christ and that they will be with Jesus in heaven. Now, on his voyage to Georgia, U.S., John Wesley's ship encountered severe storms. Other Christians who were on board with him, they were singing and praising God. They had no fear of death. Well, friends, death is the moment of truth for us all. We either make it to heaven or we don't. Well, John Wesley was rather apprehensive about death. Now ask yourself, am I sure of my salvation in Jesus Christ? You may reply, yes, I'm sure, or I'm not sure. I have discovered that people who say, "I am not sure," it is not because they have lost their faith, but rather they lack Bible scriptural knowledge regarding the salvation. For example, in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9, "For by faith you have been saved, through faith, and not of yourself. It is the gift of God." And other assurances from the Bible. Now, when John Wesley returned to England, he met up with his spiritual mentor, Peter Bowler, and others to talk about his faith. John Wesley talked sincerely to Peter about the state of his faith. You see, friends, we do need spiritual mentor who will work with us, who will counsel us on faith matters. Well, Peter Bowler, a spiritual mentor, counseled John Wesley and told him that he needed saving faith. And what is saving faith? Saving faith is a faith that believes in God and trusting in His grace to save us. And grace is about getting what we do not deserve, namely being a child of God, co-heirs with Jesus, being forgiven by God when we sin, having a place in heaven. I have always remembered what these old preachers said. And I quote, "None of us deserve to be at the communion table, but we are at the table because of God's grace." Coming to May 24, 1738, the heartwarming experience of John Wesley came with an assurance that his faith was at the right path. The faith of believing in God and trusting in His grace. Along with it came the assurance that his sin had been forgiven. The spiritual renewal of John Wesley added much aspiration and vigor to his ministry. And before I conclude, let us reflect on John Wesley's understanding of salvation. What it means to be saved. What it means to be saved. Well, by John Wesley, by salvation I mean not barely according to the notion deliverance from hell or way to heaven, but a present deliverance from sin, a restoration of the soul to its primitive health, its original purity, a recovery of the divine nature and renewal of our soul after the image of God in righteousness and true holiness. Well, let me summarize in simple language what faith entails. Well, faith is about believing in God and trusting in His grace to save us. Grace is about getting what we do not deserve, but God gives it to us. Faith is about renouncing our sin and sinful affection. Faith, salvation, is about having the divine nature that is purity. Salvation is about bearing God's image, righteousness, holiness, justice, and truth. Well, friends, John Wesley died in 1791 at the age of 88. His parting words were, "The best of all is God is with us. The best of all is God is with us." I leave these words to you. Now, John Wesley's heartwarming flame spread east to Singapore and Malaysia. Dr. James Dobbin and William Oldham arrived in Singapore on 6 February 1885. James Dobbin's first sermon was based on the scriptural text of Zechariah chapter 4 and verse 6. Not by might nor by power, but by my spirit. After his sermon, the first Methodist church was formed in Singapore with 3 members and 15 probationers. William Oldham was appointed the first pastor. From Singapore, the next Methodist church was established in Penang in 1891. And from Penang, it came to Ipoh and spread down south. It also spread to East Malaysia. Friends, let me conclude with prayer and response about a redeemed and renewed Christian. A redeemed and renewed Christian renounces sin and sinful affection in words, deeds, and thoughts. A redeemed and renewed Christian has the divine nature of purity. A redeemed and renewed Christian bears the image of righteousness, holiness, justice, and truth. Let us pray. Eternal God our Father, we ask and we pray that you continue to work in our life with the saving grace, that our lives be renewed, be made pure, and be more and more like God. And we pray, God our Father, that you continue to empower, anoint us with the Holy Spirit, and that we will continue to grow towards perfection in Jesus Christ. Hear our prayer. Do this more and more for us, towards perfection in our life, in our living. This I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Continue to worship God with the giving of our tithes, pledges, and offerings. We may give through online banking or deposit your check or cash at the OCBC bank machines. The church account details will be as shown. For those of us who use my boxes, Your collection may be handed in at the church office. Now, let us pray the offertory prayer. Let us pray. O Lord, we thank you and praise you for your goodness and faithfulness. Thank you for protecting us and providing us with our daily needs. We remember John Wesley's encouragement to us to earn all we can, save all we can, and give all we can. So now, we humbly offer to you all we can for your ministries through your church and for the furtherance of your kingdom on earth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.